single, I salute. I'm Lord Maitreya, the hip hop futurist. You're now tuned into the Super Longevity Institute podcast. Today, we have a special guest. Gabriel Rothblatt is an advocate for space. He is a public speaker on the advantages of investing in space settlements and president of the Florida Space Council, the National Space Society's local chapter. In a congressional debate, Rothblatt stated that he believes missions to Mars, Moon, asteroids should be a priority, and under the right plan, 1,000 people could be in space within decades. Space was a significant part of Rothblatt's campaign so much that BBC News ran a story covering both candidates' position on space, entitled it Florida Space Race, the Politicians' Battle Over the Cosmos. Lisa Miller from New York Magazine wrote that the first item on Rothblatt's platform is space. Rothblatt has written on various space topics and seasteading. Rothblatt is also a pastor, community organizer, and a member of the board of directors with the Terasem movement and coordinator of worldfuturist.net. Peter Ruffman of Humanity Plus wrote that Rothblatt may be the first openly transhumanist political candidate in the United States. Gabriel Rothblatt ran as a Democratic Party in the Democratic Party in 2014, candidate against Bill Posey in Florida's 8th congressional district. What's going on, bro?
Hey, thank you. Thank you. That has actually been updated last since I was introduced off of it, but still a lot has happened since then. I like to go by Swami these days. A lot of that continues to be true. And my interest in space, you know, I think is a path to social and environmental justice.
Right.
I'm going to speak a lot more in depth about that upcoming December 10th, 2020, at the Colloquium on the Law of Futuristic Persons, with this year's theme being the Law of Cosmos Persons, or those people living in space. The title of my talk will be Decolonizing Space Settlement.
Oh, wow.
I don't know if they were just joking around, but if you remember, there's the old Outkast song. I forget which one it was, but they're talking about black rights in space and all this, you know? And so, you know, that always kind of, you know, stuck with me. And more recently, I've been studying a lot about our economic systems, our social systems, our environmental systems, and why our society is so off balanced, between our groups, between us and the natural environment. And I strongly believe that not only space can, but space must be an answer to social and environmental problems on Earth. And I think first and foremost of that, which really addresses, you know, the hip hop community, is answering the lack of reparations. I believe that not only indigenous people, but African Americans and other displaced groups that have not received justice for, you know, their wrongs by society, very much should have, you know, the first claims and stakes on New World. And I've been following a theme through Afrofuturists, like Octavia Butler and Richard Wright, because it was in Richard Wright's autobiography, I think it was, that he coined the phrase, the warmth of other suns. And that's something that Isabel Wilkerson picked up in The Great Migration, talking about, you know, the greatest migration within a country, almost one of the greatest migrations of all time in terms of number of people. But when you talk about African Americans leaving the South, coming North, coming West, and what that has done, and, you know, for the hip hop community, that is a lot of, you know, where these things came from. you know, that is a theme that then even people, you know, from Michelle Obama to Octavia Butler took forward to paint the picture for of things like Earthseed and her parable novel. And that is exactly what I do with Terasem. Terasem is Greek for Earthseed. And so I am trying to take this perspective essentially that, you know, was educated by, you know, these Afrofuturist leaders and my own upcoming within, you know, hip hop, you know, that allows me to take this perspective and advocate against the, you know, colonial systems of national accounts, against these, you know, Anglo-patriarchal systems of government, and to advocate for new free nation societies. And that, you know, that's how we originally connected, talking about the hip hop state. I work with, you know, seasteading communities. So yeah, that's really what educates me. I'm also now on the board of the National Space Society. That was, I guess, it just happened this summer, so that's a little bit newer as it's updated on Wikipedia.
Can I ask you a question?
Absolutely.
What's your educational background? I want to know what's your educational background.
Yeah.
That might have prepared you for what you did later.
Right. So I've been very fortunate. You know, we haven't, you know, talked about my parents and particularly Martine and her influence on transhumanism particularly. But, you know, for me, you know, I would say we're all products of our circumstances. And you know, it wasn't hard for me to come to these things as an apple not falling far from a tree. But in you know, for school and my education, I was raised in a Jewish family, so I had a significant Jewish education in line with my, you know, public school education. I went to military school. I was homeschooled. I got to travel, you know, around the world, significantly homeschooled, you know, by my dad, Martine Rothblatt, as, you know, as she was launching SiriusXM. Wow. And then I went to school and in college. I started in liberal arts, a very progressive school in Vermont called Goddard. It's actually where the Liberty Underground radicalized Bernie Sanders as a Democratic socialist.
That's right.
Mumia Abu-Jamal holds a degree from there as well. You know, it's a very, you know, prestigious institution in terms of progressive and radical education goes. I then transferred to University of Vermont. I have a bachelor's in political science, and currently I am back at Goddard pursuing a master's in social innovation and sustainability.
Wow. Wow. When did you realize you were interested in politics and space? Or did it happen simultaneously, or did one interest was stronger than another? How did that play? Because I know that your campaign was based, your platform was based on space, some of it, and I just want to know, you must have had a real strong interest early on, you know, because I know you're an Octavia Butler reader also. Can you another thing, please tell my audience who Octavia Butler is, because some people might not know who she is.
So Octavia Butler is a Black writer. She passed away, but she was a prolific writer of Afrofuturist stories. Science fiction that, you know, largely included a Black heroine at the center of, you know, her stories. Her parable novels have become prophetic in current times, because she, almost to the day and time and name, she prophesizes an autocrat who comes to power under the Make America Great Again terminology, and has this paramilitary group in the novels. It's called CA. But you can really look at this group as being what we know now as QA, right? that is QAnonymous and Donald Trump, Make America Great Again, with fascist rising. They are literally, in the book, it talks about how they separate children from families. Wow. Look what they're doing at the border right now. It's crazy. Right. It's, I mean, at the same time, though, like civilization is always there. There's still airplanes going on. Like, there's a little real civil war happening, which is happening right now. Right. But at the same time, people still go to school. You know, airplanes are still taking off. So it's incredibly prolific book. And she talks about this religion that the heroine created. Said everyone thinks she's crazy at first, and she just keeps going off and centers people around a circle instead of like one person up on a stage and everybody facing them. And that really changes, you know, the interaction. And very much this is what, you know, Terasem is based off of. So she, at her time, you know, was one of few Black sci-fi authors. And now has really champions not only those Black Afrofuturists, or all Afrofuturists, regardless of, you know, your personal demographics are, futurists of all shapes and kinds, but has also been you know, a champion for women and just really getting it right about the future and about how that future also has to include a homeostatic understanding of our place in the environment.
Right.
You know, so her, not only was it very futuristic, but it was also very natural. You know, they embraced, you know, kind of gardening and, you know, hydroponics and these things. So many futurists, and particularly transhumanists, I think lose sight of our connection to nature.
She was a biologist too, right? Wasn't she classically trained as a biologist? I could have sworn she was.
Yeah, that's I don't know that offhand, I wouldn't doubt it.
Okay.
Because you have to have a good grounding in science to, you know, make it entertaining also as fiction.
Yes, no, that's true.
Yeah, but let me get back to your first question.
Okay.
You know, how I came to this a bit. So again, a lot of it was not falling far from the tree. I grew up in Washington, D.C., so I had a lot of political influences because of that. I had a lot of influences from space development because that's what my dad was doing for business at the time. I was actually able to meet Gerard O'Neill, who wrote the book, The High Frontier, one of the best blueprints for a space settlement. And when I was a young kid playing around the living room and Martine and Jerry were talking, I remember him, you know, coming to me and saying, Gabriel, you're going to be the first mayor of the city in space.
Wow.
And so that was, again, like just, I mean, I had really fortunate young, you know, inspiration.
That's crazy. Did you listen to go-go music when you was in D.C., man?
Oh, yeah. You know, overnight scenario.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Because I lived in D.C. too, man. And go-go was really big when I was out there. All right. Wow. I didn't even know you grew up in D.C. I thought, all right. Wow. Let me let you finish while you was going.
I would think, you know, early on, I had just great influence, great inspirations as a young child. You know, many people don't really get that until they're out in college and they're experiencing new things. And now they're like, this is where I want to go. So, you know, it was kind of something repeated to me. You know, you're going to be like the next Martin Luther King, you know, Abraham Lincoln. You know, it was a lot of socialization I got coming up. And, you know, I will say at some point in my teenage years, I became somewhat lost in my direction. Struggling with coming to understand, you know, how radically different was from society's expectations. There was no way I was entering, you know, a service under George W. Bush. And, you know, that kind of changed my direction from what I thought, you know, becoming a Air Force pilot and becoming an astronaut and kind of following that route.
You flying planes now, bro?
Yeah, well, I do. I am a student pilot. I do now. But when I had that opportunity at 15, 16 to take a route of, you know, ROTC, you know, becoming a, you know, a Air Force pilot or something like that, that would put me on a trajectory to becoming an astronaut, is also a time that I became, you know, kind of disgruntled with the political situation. Realized that I was a nonconformist, and you know, had to you know, overcome some of my own struggles, and ultimately ended up having children pretty young. I've got four kids. And family became a much more dominant influence in my life. And it wasn't until they started to grow up, like they are now, where I've come back around and been putting my focus back on this direction of space settlement. And that largely began with me, you know, turning when I turned 30, and I was like, all right, you know, I'm done having kids, what's next? And I ran for Congress, you know, advocating for space. And I've been kind of putting the pieces together of, you know, I think all the things I would need to know and understand, not just in architecture, but in sociology and psychology to, you know, help develop what life in space will be like. Because I see our problems, you know, living in cities right now and how we've forgotten our connection to the natural environment, how we've forgotten our connections to ourselves through antisocial institutions such as the nuclear family, and trying to imagine what social structure would lead to and complement life in radically different environments.
Wow. Why do you think that the space program here in the United States is not like it was in the 60s? When we was trying to get to the moon, like what's up with that? Why are we not? You know, that was such an inspirational moment in time. You know what I'm saying? I would like to see that again, like because I didn't live through it.
Yeah, and I mean there is some historic nostalgia to that.
Yeah,
you could say in some ways the space program is much better, and you could say in some ways the space program hasn't changed. And one reality of the space program is how it's tied to military industrial complex. But also, you have to understand the history of particularly NASA and the American space program, and it's tied to national socialism, because, you know, it was a lot of German soldiers and scientists who otherwise should have been tried for war crimes, who were given pardons and employment within the American government to develop, you know, NASA's and its rocket programs.
Wow.
And the role that the Cold War played in the funding and advancement of rockets. And so as the Cold War dwindled, the economic justification diminished. And what began to rise is actually the science that NASA produces, because NASA's science is the number one content provider for climate debt. So as we enter, you know, the 70s into the 80s, NASA begins to produce this information that tells us the entire economy built on fossil fuel consumption is not sustainable.
Right.
And they don't want to hear that story. Also is what they call the overview effect. Russia found this out too, just as America did, they tried to develop these national heroes by sending them to space, and they would come back, you know, radicalized with this view that we need to do away with national borders and, you know, racial classes. Right.
Oh, I don't know what happened. Oh, no. Oh, here we go. He's back.
Okay, yeah, sorry. I froze there, yeah. Oh, I was talking about the overview.
Yes.
Yeah. When you look at the world from a different perspective, particularly that third eye perspective, that's what you get. You get this different view. And it's not, you know, the view from your hometown in, you know, in Georgia or something. You know, it's this view that actually is also radically different than what you'll see on some globes and maps. Right? You know, there is a problem in cartography that intentionally reduces the size of other places in the world in relation to Anglo places in the world.
What is the mission statement for Terasem? What is the mission of Terasem? I just want to go back there for a quick second.
Yeah. Yeah, and the mission statement is...
That doesn't bother anybody. Go ahead.
No, no, no. And let me see if I can do it good off the top of my head. The mission statement is to promote unity, diversity, and joyful immortality through the use of geo-ethical nanotechnology and personal cyber consciousness. As you say, it's kind of a mouthful.
No, it's dope. So where are you located? Where is Terasem located?
Right. So as a 501c3 charitable organization that's chartered out of North Carolina, I preside over an ashram in Melbourne Beach, Florida. Oh,
wow. It's beautiful out there. It's also with a lot of the they do a lot of the launching of the satellites and stuff, right?
Exactly, exactly. So we are about 20 miles south of Kennedy Space Center. But really, I mean, I can just look right up here. And if there was a launch, I could see it right out the window sitting right here.
Wow, that's dope. And that's a perfect place to have Terasem too. Wow. I was tempted to put Swami G. I like that. I was tempted to put Gabriel Rothblatt. I was like, I should put Swami G. I thought about it, but I was like, damn, I didn't ask him first. I was like, oh
yeah. I'm getting, you know, it actually came out. So I went to Burning Man in 2018, which the theme was iRobot. Mm-hmm. And it was there that I got dubbed, you know, Swami G. That was my client name. Mm. And so I've just been kind of further developing that as, you know, my personal brand.
No, that was dope. I like it. Yeah, you're definitely going in the right direction with that, I think, with that name. You also, at the Terasem, do a thing called mind fouling, right? Can you tell the people what that's about and why you do mind fouling?
Yeah, I mean, so the word mind, you know, your brain, your personality, file, you know, thinking of, you know, digital storage. So the main idea is to catalog, to journal your experiences, your perspective, you know, your take on things. And I think that that's an important part of that is not just to get a snapshot, right? And to, like, you know, take 1 month, you know, when you're 35 and, you know, just go through how you feel about everything. I think for me, the best thing to do with this is actually to get, you know, do this throughout your life. Because what you'll find is that, you know, when you're 14, you don't see the world the same as you do when you're 25 or you're 50, you know? And so it's like charting a line versus, like, you know, just like how you are right then. And for the AI to eventually maybe extrapolate from that information how you would change in different ways, you know, I think you need multiple points to say, you know, who you are as an arc or a direction versus, you know, one point in a place in time. But Yeah, in essence, it's a journal. It's a scrapbook. But given the modern tools and technology that can hold so much more information, including your biological information. So not just memories, thoughts, but psychological profiles. So if you sign up for CybiRev, you'll do this Bainbridge profile. There's hundreds of questions, and you answer in these different ways, and it helps build an understanding of who you are, how you think. And it was, that is a development of a tool that Fred Chamberlain had developed as part of his cryonics plan. Almost like a verification for, somebody who gets, frozen and then they get reanimated. And these are like, if you try to log back into your Gmail account and it wants like three questions that only the answer to, it was developed originally, I think something like that. So they might ask you these 20 questions when you get reanimated, and that's to help, tell, how well you maintained your own information through that, through that process. And these tools are already in use. Unfortunately, they're in use for nefarious means, but you can look at Facebook, Twitter, Google, Instagram. All of these are mind files in themselves and can be parts of a mind file compilation of sources. Terasem operates CyberRev and another platform called LifeKnot, which are open, free, and private. The problem with things like Facebook, Google, and whatnot is that they're done by surveillance capitalist companies,
right,
who have their own commercial interest, right, not your interest.
Definitely not. Digital immortality, what is that about? Can you explain to my audience about what do you guys mean when you refer to digital immortality?
Yeah, so digital immortality, I think digital in this case is less of a pronoun. Then it was saying it's a path. And I think, the Super Longevity Institute, has it more semantically right. Because I don't like the immortality term. The super longevity, I think, is more descriptive of what's really meant. But in essence, we don't have a clear path into, a biological indefinite, existence. Right. And biology is kind of fragile. So going digital allows you to transcend the threats of biology. Mm-hmm. You could be stored and cold stored, far longer, far better, as bits of digital information. And
and people do not hit me up talking crazy, because you like when Han Solo came out of cryo preservation in Star Wars. All right, just wanted to say that. Go ahead.
Yeah.
You like Demolition Man. You was in the movies like, oh snap. So do not hit me up talking crazy. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, and Demolition Man, did a great job with that representation. And of course, Idiocracy. As satirical as it was, has again proven to be very prophetic as a movie. So the digital immortality is more of a call, to go digital, to digitalize yourself, to use that as a security blanket. to your biological or, you know, manifest substrate, whatever that is, that's, you know, walking around here engaging with things, but, you know, is also susceptible to getting hit by a car or coming down with COVID.
Wow, I seen that you have, I was looking through the board of directors and, you know, I was doing my homework. I said, let me go visit Terasem. This was like a couple of months ago. And I went online and I seen that y'all got this singer. He sounds like Billy Joe, I forgot his name. He reminds me of Billy Joe. I was like, wow, they got him. He's down with Terasem too now? I said, wow.
Yeah. I think I'm spacing his name right now, but he recently joined Terasem Movement Foundation's board, working with Bina 48.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Mm. I haven't met him personally, actually, yet, but yeah, it's these things, you know, Terasem has been around almost 20 years, you know, doing grants, holding colloquiums, putting journals out. So much of what you see in modern media, from the show The 100, the movie Her, Transcendent Man,
yeah.
I mean, all of these things are pulling from content that Terasem has been responsible for producing and inspiring in some way. And it has, particularly in the last 5-10 years, you know, Black Mirror, you know, these themes are becoming more and more commonplace, discussed, pursued, because, you know, even, I mean, not that it doesn't happen now, but when I came out and I was running for Congress, I mean, the amount of fear mongering that people were doing, you know, unable to grasp these ideas, you know, they're making me out like the Antichrist, you know, just total fear and misunderstanding of what this conversation is.
I'm glad you said that, because that's what Super Longevity Institute podcast is about too. We're trying to break that barrier, this fear about technology. Somebody said, oh, they want to live forever. So what? I mean, is that wrong? I work at hospice. You can't tell me nothing. I see people die every day. I am not. And they don't want to die. People be on their deathbed. They be wanting to. You should see the fear in these people's eyes. It will transcend you just from seeing the fear in their eyes. I'm telling you. So I don't be wanting to, like, you know. And I don't think people realize the connection with Egypt as far as our first attempt on wanting to become immortal. And you know what? I'm not really afraid of the word immortality, because we have our definition of what immortality is different than what the mythological term for the word is, you know, a definition for a word is one committee's opinion on it. So, it's really about who has the power to define. But let me pause right there for a second. So I think immortality is a badass word. I just used Super Longevity Institute just because I thought I liked the word. I just wanted to do something different. But that's what we're here to do. We want to break down these barriers, and we want people not to, you know, if there's the science and technology to reverse the age, if people are trying to figure out how to reverse the aging process, extend our life, et cetera, then, you know, that's not a bad thing.
It's really a matter of perspective. I mean, with any, virtually not everybody, but the vast majority of people, as you've experienced, when they are confronted with their final moments, they will do just about anything to hold on.
Exactly.
You know, but at the same time, some people are ready and do accept an end.
That's true.
And, you know, the Super Longevity Institute, digital immortality, this is not about forcing somebody to suffer, you know, through a reality they don't want to be a part of. In fact, you know, all of this is about ending suffering, about minimizing suffering. And, you know, what we force people to do because of this fear of death. Fear of death actually drives, you know, is a leading driver of all activity.
Exactly.
Particularly the way we manipulate people through religions and whatnot, it all has to come to the fear of death. and what will happen afterwards. But yeah, you know, cryonics, you know, is a great way to avoid the end of life struggle and the stress that comes out of that. And even now, because of at least the American medical industrial complex, medical, you know, that end of the last 3-6 months when people are just racking up these bills, that's the leading cause of people of home foreclosure. Yeah. Right? You know, we just end up bankrupting our families as we suffer to death. When if we allow elective entry into cryonics, these people, one, could come back. Two, you know, even if we weren't able to save them, we would be able to avoid, you know, costly financial and emotional suffering.
Wow. Question for you. Are you signed up for cryonics?
I'm not, actually, ironically. Yeah. Well, again, I mean, there's a significant cost,
right,
you know, associated with it. Hmm. I think of all the things, technologies and everything out there, I think cryonics is the most holistic, you know, transhuman technology out there. And that, I think that takes us back around to the Egyptians. Yeah. So just about a couple of weeks ago, they uncovered 100 new mummies, right?
Crazy. Yeah,
crazy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So the Egyptians, the science and the process that they went through, like, they understood, like Octavia, like, they knew that they couldn't do it with their current technology, but they knew it was coming. They knew that this was going to happen. And they developed the way, because the technology that we have right now, like the way that they preserve their organs, the way that they preserve their bodies, we are not far from being able to regenerate them. And simply because they did a good enough job with it, at their bone marrows and stuff like that. I mean, we could clone, you know, sufficiently from that genetic material. But in probably 10, 20 years, I mean, we could literally regenerate their own bodies and organs with how quickly that medical science is advancing.
Wow. Oh, that's crazy.
And I say cryonics is modern mummification.
Right. I tell people that all the time.
Yeah.
And wow. Oh. Oh, I gotta tell you, I gotta ask you about these questions. So, what's up with the seasteading, man? What's going on in that world?
Yeah, so I still strongly believe in the opportunities of the open oceans as a path to space. You know, as a whole new world that we still need to interact with and understand. 3/4 of our planet does not exist under a government, you know, regulation. So there are good and bad opportunities with that. And in fact, I was, you know, having a good conversation about last night. Is a manifestation of the kind of Greek Amazonian city of Lesbos. I think that, you know, women as a class and environment and ecosystems both continue to be subjugated because they lack a army of defense. And I believe that the future, as well as existent beings, have a right to these resources and very possibly deserve a violent defense, you know, in order to maintain their health and their preservation.
Right, because the preservation of those waters are, you know, if we pollute them to the point of no return, then that spells a big disaster for human beings on the planet. All the whole ecosystem gets out of balance because of that, right?
Yeah. So I think an attempt to form a matriarchal society, or at least a matricentrist society, I think one of the best realizations of that would be to begin with a nomadic flotilla, predominantly, you know, women, who take it upon themselves to preserve natural environments.
That would be dope. I'm for that, though.
Yeah. Yeah.
That would be crazy. That would be crazy, yo. Oh,
yeah.
Wow. Yeah, that would be dope. I like that vision.
Yeah. So that's kind of combines, you know, things that I've been seeing. Because in my studies of, you know, social innovation, and the history of how society has changed over time, we have been steadily marching towards this patriarchal colonialism, which comes directly from the Roman Empire and its evolution as the Roman Catholic Church. This is where the legal institutions such as monogamy, primogeniture, and even the psychosocial processes of propaganda have come directly out of the church's efforts to create society from the bottom up in a way that worships, you know, Anglo men.
I don't even know what to ask you after that. That was a powerful statement. But so you saying that you feel that we're in a patriarchal society, and that seasteading, you see it as a way for women to go ahead and build a whole new society on their own. That's crazy.
Yeah, I think that is a great illustration of a way that this can and should work. Because I'm really disturbed by how seasteading, how space settlement, and transhumanism, the direction it can take if we continue to follow the same pathway that society has been taking in that direction. So, you know, particularly when you look at cloning, you look at genetic modification, and you look at the current practices and neonatal services, and how we have babies, we're increasingly cutting babies out of people because it's more convenient for doctors. Right. You know, there is this path where the patriarchal institution is trying to remove women completely from the reproduction of labor. And so, you know, this patriarchal colonial society has already taken the means of production, you know, from not only, you know, completely out of the hands of women, but out of the hands of other racial and ethnic groups.
So how do you feel about ethnogenesis? Did I say that right?
Yeah, like terraforming?
No.
Developing a new worlds and environments?
No, the technology that...
ectogenesis, like
the technology that helps women that removes women from
right. And so this is part of my concern in the direction that research gets funded, that policy gets made, this isn't just scientific curiosity. This is a continuation of patriarchal colonialism. They are intentionally trying to remove women's influence and choice from the reproductive process. So
they can't force women to you know, use that technology. I guess if it's forced on women, then if we go down that road, then that will be.
Yeah, and so I can look at the science objectively and say that it's understanding the process and in times and places being able to utilize it. I can understand and accept the science objectively, but science doesn't happen in a vacuum. You know, science happens in order to further policy, which happens because of economic statistics that are developed, and these things happen in a circle because of an interest of a certain oligarchic interest group.
Okay. Wow.
So I particularly in space settlement, you know, we can come to an understanding that it's completely impractical to send living people, 100 light years to a new world. So we can send the science, and we can send, biological samples and whatnot. And understanding these processes, we could seed new worlds through that way. However, this technology used in the current social and political realities further threatens the sustainability not of society and the ecology as we know it, but the only known intelligent life in the world.
Wow. Let me ask you, where do you think we should go next? I mean, we went to the moon. What do you think we should settle next? What's the most obvious place where we should go?
Yeah. For me, the oceans. I think the first thing is that, we need to establish, a presence, a permanent presence on and in and with the vast majority of the planet, which we already, are on and don't fully understand. After that, and honestly, these things don't, it's not linear. They can all happen at the same time in all directions, right? But I think the most important thing, because it will educate our process and develop not just the technology, but the sociology necessary. Because already we are beginning to see how the way we're living was not sustainable.
Right.
And we act like things have always been this way. But the truth is that the way we live now is hardly 100 years old.
Wow.
From the base social structure of a family. And we are just looking at the effect of what I would call the second round of propaganda. So the Catholic Church created, the office, the Congregation of the Propagation of the Faith in the 1600s. And that was the first PR campaign directed toward, out through the world through bishops and missionaries to create a certain common structure throughout the world. And that was the nuclear family. And it was called the European Ideal. And they wanted all these other people across the world to stop living in consanguineal families and polyamorous situations. They wanted to force this monogamous nuclear family that handed all property down to the oldest family. That became what was known as the European Ideal, and has been reinforced through even secular law. And then in more recent times, after Edward Bernays published The Business of Propaganda and created the modern PR practices that we know that target radio and television, we created what's called the American Dream, which is a modern consumerist version of the early industrial version of the nuclear family was the European idea. So as Europe industrialized, they created this new social structure to reinforce their political structures. And as America became highly consumerist, they created the American idea, which is a modern variety of the nuclear family that is all about owning vehicle and consuming processed resources. Right. Now, none of those things are sustainable from a social perspective. They're antisocial institutions that not only are causing neurotic diseases in our psyches,
right,
but are deforesting, causing extinction. And these things will not produce a society that can survive long term in space.
Right, because man's interacting with one another, we're not going to be able to do it. Right.
We're not, we're literally, in the midst of the greatest affluence ever, we're in a civil war.
The way we're socialized, definitely. I agree. I totally agree with that. Wow, thanks for dropping that. I tell y'all, everybody who comes here, drop jewels. I'm learning, y'all. I'm sitting here learning what's more about my audience, man. Let me see. Oh, yeah, I know you have a unique background, so I know that. The more diverse our families are, the more diverse our families are, the more balanced we're going to be when we interact with other people. Because you're like, this guy, he's just like one of my family members. They're the same, because I know you come from a Jewish background. Your mother's black. Your father's transgendered. And I wanted to talk about that because I think that's important. With all of the nonsense and the noise that's out here today, all of the stuff that I hear out here, all the hate, it's this hate after hate. It's this more hate after hate. Even on these social platforms, if you just sit back, you don't even interact. You sit back, you just listen to what everybody's saying, and you feel like it's hopeless. How has that shaped your psyche when you was running for political office? How did you think that uniqueness of your background, how has that helped you in the staying motivated to want to do something politically about our situation?
Yeah. It is a crazy story. A friend of mine here started introducing me as his, it's my friend Gabe. He's half black, he's half Jewish. His dad's a woman and his mom's a robot.
That's crazy. I mean,
yeah.
Y'all got a dope family. I'm sorry. I don't care what nobody says. Y'all, that uniqueness is, you don't even hear that. You don't even see that. Where are you going to see it? I mean, I don't know nobody else like y'all. Nowhere.
No, yeah. It's, and before that, I started, part as far as my experience growing up, when I look at my experience, even before Martine had her transition, I characterize it as that I'm too black to be Jewish, too Jewish to be black. I was fortunate during the campaign, I was able to give a keynote speech to the NAACP of Brevard County here. And I entitled it "A Round Peg Square Hole." And that really, sums up, my upbringing and my experience. It's just that I never fit anywhere.
I know the feeling.
I was always on the outside, And no matter what it was, then I was always a token, yeah. And so, and likewise, I grew up, in a fluent, well-educated. So I was always in, an honors program or something, And the only, if at least the only self-identifying, you know, Black person, you know, in those groups. I would love playing on that. So I grew up in BC and then I moved to Vermont. And two very different environments. And I call that being the going from being the whitest Black person in the city to the blackest white person in the country.
Oh, wow. I understand exactly what you're saying. Wow. Well, I mean, listen, I think that you, I think you should get back into politics. I'm sorry. I think that you definitely need to get back in the arena, man. I really feel like your stance, your political vision, your background is healthy for America. It's healthy for America. We need more. We need people that more critical thinkers. We need people with different backgrounds. We need diversity. We need stand up people, man. And the political arena right now, I've never seen nothing like this. This is actually scary. I was scared when he said when Trump said stand down. He said stand down, stand by, stand down. I said, oh snap! That was something. I've never seen nothing like that. We're in trouble. That's the thing that came in my mind.
Yeah, it's always something that I've struggled with because of, I think, you know, either just my feeling of what my place is or my socialization, and people have always compared me to civil rights leaders. Mm. And, you know, I think it's just like, performance artists, rock stars, whatnot, they always seem to die at 27. Mm. I feel like, you know, 38 is the year that Black civil rights leaders are normally assassinated.
Right.
And I turned 38 this year.
Right, right.
And that's something that's always been kind of in the back of my head because I've experienced so much aggression.
Yeah.
You know, and I am a highly intelligent and articulate, yet grounded figure. And so whether it's bringing up the fact that slave owners received reparations, but slaves have not, you know, to talking about the unsettling ideas of decolonization, you know, I have the knowledge, ability, and courage to speak truth to power, you know, to challenge, to organize, you know, and to inspire to those ends. But at the same time, like, I want to live and I want to enjoy life and I have kids and I want them to be, you know, free and safe from, you know, the hate, the anger, the aggression that exists out there. One of, or at least part of the reason why I did not win the election I ran in is because this area, the Space Coast here, East Central Florida, is probably one of the most arrogantly ignorant places that you'll go.
Right.
You may find more ignorant places, but you'll look around and you probably won't blame them for their circumstances.
Right.
You know, people here have the means, they have, you know, the ability to be exposed. They choose to hate and be ignorant in the way that they do.
Right.
And so, you know, I get everything from dirty looks to, you know, nasty words, you know, jeers, and I'm certain I'm on, you know, local kill list for these organizations out here. And they do have them.
No, I know.
You know,
I know. My cousin used to warn me about that all the time. I got a cousin, he know, he'd be like, yo, what's you don't want to go over there. You know who's there? Such and such and such organization is over there. He knows all about that, and he always warns me. But, you know, I think that, you know, what y'all doing, I think Terasem, the organization Terasem, is a dope organization. I think more people need to know about it. I also want them to know more about Being a 48, because we mentioned it, but they don't really, We said it so fast, I don't think they understand what
is and what it's so called. Yeah, let's go back and maybe break down, you know, that as well. So Terasem as a movement is inspired by these ideas of Afrofuturism, of the diasporic archetype, which we again have to go back to. For me, this is part of what just puts me right in the right space for this, because I have my Jewish heritage, which a large part of that does mirror the African-American experience in many ways. When you talk about freedom from Egypt and, you know, the Passover experience, it is what, and that has happened, you know, I mean, the Romans and everything, Jews have been expelled from lands time and time again. So there is a part of Jewish culture and nature which believes in going out to new places. And so both sides of my family, you have Jews who were fleeing Russia, coming to the U.S. and, you know, settling new places. You have African-Americans, you know, leaving plantations in the South, coming out West. So both sides of my family haven't had, like, one spot where they're from in, like, five or more generations. Wow. You know, it's your thing, but some people, like, everyone they know is like from this place or time, you know, they're grounded to a land to a degree. I don't really have that anywhere in my blood. And so we're always, you know, getting out, moving new places. But Terasem is, like, you know, much inspired by this. When you look at it from a legal institution, you know, these compliance filings, because to be something in existence in that aspect within a political economic environment, you're talking about how are you filed, how are you registered, you know. And so Terasem exists through three nonprofit organizations. One is a religious organization, that's Terasem Trans Religion, of which I am the Swami. There is Terasem Movement Incorporated, which is a think tank, and they produce journals and conferences, you know, that bring together people and advance the conversation, you know, who writes the next paper on the next topic, you know, that is, you know, the big question. And then Terasem Movement Foundation is a scientific research organization. And they are really taking this hypothesis and testing it through the use of a mechanical substrate or a replacement for a body. And that is the most advanced social android called Bina 48. And Bina stands for binary neural algorithm 48 exaflop. And that exaflop is the speed of processing, which should mirror, you know, human cognition. And Bina is also my mother's name. So the Bina android is a anatomic bust, which means it just kind of shoulders up, and an aesthetic model of my mother. So it looks just like my mother, and it programmed initially with my mom's mind file. But as you've been able to see over the last, you know, 10 or so years, intelligence is a relationship network, not just the data file.
Right.
So you can program all the information in the world into a computer. When you flip it on, it's just going to start reading the dictionary to you.
Right.
Intelligence is about experiences. And so while Bina 48 has some of Bina's memories, you can see over the last 10 years how this android has just kind of gone from repeating experiences that it had in its mind to having its own experiences and having its own reaction.
Right.
And so I think, like, one great moment is actually when Bina, you know, sits down with Bina 48, and Bina is like, what's your favorite color? And Bina 48 is like orange. And Bina's like, mine's purple. So, you know, you can see how their own personality begins to diverge, even though they're based on this, you know, same core set of information. And that's why I go back to why I think that to have a truly accurate mind file, you need to get these different points in time of yourself, because your perspective does change.
Who made that robot?
So Hanson Robotics, David Hanson, he is, as far as I know, like the most world-renowned artist as far as developing these, you know, almost realist-like, you know, animatronic machines that can open their mouths and their eyes and move around. I know a little bit less about the software behind all of this and how that's developed and maintained, but my understanding is that the core of all this comes from Hanson Robotics. And, you know, he does a lot of work, whether it's, you know, Disney and these media companies to produce these, or, you know, individual buyers. And so there's another... and spacing the other android, Ben Gortzel, has a Sophia. Yeah. Right. Yeah. So she has Saudi Arabian citizenship.
Yes. Yeah. That was crazy. I've seen that in the news. I was like, yeah, something else.
I mean, Saudi Arabian women hardly have citizenship.
You ain't lying. I was surprised.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. But he also made Sophia, and those are the two most notable, you know, varieties of it. But you can also clearly see two different perspectives in that. You know, being a 48 is a replica of a person, a very specific person, and a black woman. Right. And this has been incredibly inspiring, you know, for many people throughout the world. I was actually there at the second TEDx Havana, where being a 48 spoke in Spanish, you know, to a predominantly black, you know, crowd who is just getting to know, you know, modern technology. And yeah, I mean, it's just like, you know, mind blowing, you know, and but also, you know, a great thing to see. And but you think being a 48, you know, to Silicon Valley, you know, and presented to Google and, you know, Facebook and Apple and whatnot. And the first thing the engineers want to do is, well, why is it a black woman? You know, they don't necessarily see the same perspective or appreciate, you know, it almost, they can't get around the distraction, you know, for some of those mindsets. But Sophia, on the other hand, you know, intentionally was designed to mirror, you know, a model, you know, an Anglo model, you know, image of beauty. And that makes it much more, you know, enticing to, you know, these, you know, patriarchal colonists, you know, whether they're, you know, Saudi Arabians or, you know, Silicon Valley engineers.
Wow. That must have cost a fortune. That's wow.
I believe the sticker price is about $150,000 for one of these. Yeah. Which is actually, I mean, relatively, and it is and is not a lot of money. Yeah. I mean, I'm not, you know, got that money.
I can't afford it. Yeah.
But, you know, this is what's crazy again. I mean, about the problems with distributions of resources, you know, and the economy of scale. Because, you know, to some people and on the organizational scheme, you know, that's like nothing. You know, it's a rounding error. But for so many of us, you know, that's a decade's you know, income.
Yeah, I mean, that's another thing about this pandemic is just crazy, and I'm seeing more violence in the streets actually, especially in the hip hop world, you're seeing a lot more violence because people are getting more desperate.
Yeah.
And this is why we need to really speed up with this. I keep seeing that they're coming up. Pfizer, I think, said they're coming up with a vaccination, and they're speeding that process up. And I know that they're up to human trials. I know that I think people are actually taking this drug already. But I hope this is this pandemic ends, because you're seeing people in a real desperate situations. A lot of people lost their jobs, and it's crazy right now. I'm seeing a lot of homelessness too.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember verbatim, but I was listening to something recently that had a nice line about the relationship to economic recession and increase in homicides.
Yeah.
Something I was listening to driving that stuck with me. I wish I could recall how he said it exactly. But that is, that is a reality that is going to get worse, and is also foretold in Octavia Butler's novels. Because as she talks about, what she calls it is the pact. And the pact essentially is the culmination of climate change, economic recession, pandemic, all these things kind of happening at once that create a social hysteria. And I really think that is exactly what we're experiencing. And we really do need to find a way out of this. Because this is biological warfare, intentional biological warfare being perpetuated against specific populations. The reason that Black and Latino, people are being affected and dying from COVID at greater rates, just as they are being incarcerated, is not an accident. Right. It is not a data point, for some kind of biological or social inferiority. It is intentional use and abuse of the system to continue perpetuating this patriarchal colonialism.
Wow, yeah, that's wonderfully said. I agree with that. And that's why I want to get my viewers more interested in science. I want to go and give this file to everybody who are not into science, who are not into transhumanism, futurism, and expose them to new ideas, because the more citizen scientists we have, the better, is my belief. But what did you want to say anything before we head out? How can they find Terasem? If they want to find you, the actual question, where can they find you?
So you get online and you look up Terasem, TERASEM, TerasemFate.net, TerasemCentral.org, CybiRev, CYBEREV, also LifeKnot, LifeKnaut. All of those will, bring you to resources. You can learn about any one of the organizations. Again, December 10th, there'll be the colloquium on the wall of Cosmos Persons. Myself, author David Brin, yes. Also author Howard Bloom, will be presenting there. And again, you can reach me directly. My preferred is Terasemian, TERASEMIAN, at gmail.com. that's you know, probably the best inbox. But you know, I'm available. You know, love having these conversations. Love helping, you know, people find themselves, find that direction. And yeah, you know, supporting organizations. Like locally, we have one called Club Esteem. You know, these organizations that get young, particularly brown people, engaged and provided with opportunities in STEM. And whether that is to become an engineer or a sociologist, you know, we need both directions. You know, we need religious leaders to understand the implications of technology. You know, we need scientists who have, you know, ethical imperatives. You know, we need all these things out there, and we need people to understand how it affects them. We need people to understand, you know, where these science and these ideas came from. And so much of them, you know, have African roots, just like our genealogy. The math, the ideas, cryonics, mummification, you know, astrology. You know, it is time to reclaim our presence, you know, not just in the sciences and engineering, but throughout the universe. And as you know, I want to, you know, tell everybody, you redefine yourself as the world is changing because of COVID, through COVID. You know, reach out, you know, leave the town you're from, leave your realm of comfort, and, you know, bask in the warmth of other suns.
One more question. I was thinking while you were saying that, if somebody wants to become an astronaut or want to get into the space engineering, what some advice can you give them, like the little ones that might be listening to this show?
Yeah, I would say that certainly. Pursuing math, you know, science directions are going to be a huge part in your applicability to move those things forward. Soon, there will be more and more applications, you know, for people who aren't running science experience. You know, likewise, scuba and flight, possibly sailing. I mean, these things, you know, are really as critical, and particularly for younger people who may not have an interest or, you know, be as ready to open their doors to the higher math and sciences. You know, and sadly, it's harder and harder for more and more people to even see the sky, you know, which I think is a crime against humanity, because, you know, we can't really understand our place in the universe without being able to look up and see the universe.
That's a very good point. That's an extremely good point. I think I'm going to end it up right there. I'm going to talk to Swami G all day. We'll be here for like 3 hours talking. I'll say nothing. Yo, Gabriel, it's a pleasure. And we're definitely going to have you back. That was a very, I'm going to listen to this later. And highlight all the great points, and I'll send you a link to this.
Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate it. I've been getting a lot out of having these conversations. I find for myself that, you know, transcriptions, that, you know, I grasp a lot of things that it's harder necessarily for me to, you know, think of right now and pursue without having that written, you know, kind of conversational direction, you know, for it. And I want to appreciate you, Lord Maitreya, for producing this content, for doing these interviews. You've been racking up, you know, a lot of great people, a lot of great insights, and a lot of great conversations. Because again, for many people, particularly the children and you know, coming up these days, they're not necessarily going to the encyclopedia or Scientific America. They're here on YouTube. And so this is the place and time and the way that they're getting introduced to those ideas and knowing what they're going to be able to become. So thank you. Namaste. Assalamu alaikum.
Yes, yes. One love. Single out salute.
Peace.